Okay, I think we should start. Hello, everybody. My name is Oleg, and I would like to present you a talk about GraphQL, and in particular, how you can build GraphQL API with Sangria. So, but before we start, I prepared a lot of demos, and it would be a step-by-step walkthrough. And if you would like to follow along with the code, you can just go to this link. It's a GitHub repository, and it contains some documentation as well as some steps, and you can follow along as I will show it to you on the screen. Also, for later on, the demo contains a little bit more examples than I will show you today, so this might be helpful for you if this is something you are interested in. Okay, so first, a small question before we start. How many of you heard about GraphQL or used GraphQL? Oh, wow, it's a lot of people. Great. So for those of you who haven't heard about GraphQL and don't know what it is, or just trying it out. So the GraphQL is a data query language. It was developed by Facebook, and it was used at Facebook since 2012. Which means that the way Facebook used the GraphQL API was in context of mobile applications. It was a time when they started to implement iOS and Android applications, and they still had this web-based UI at that time. And they actually, in fact, tried to use REST API. But unfortunately, after some attempts, it was not really working for them. And today we will look why precisely it was not working for them, at least some of the reasons for this. So in 2012, they started to work on GraphQL. And in July 2015, they open sourced it. And what they open sourced was the actual specification. So, which means that this is not a library, this is not a specific piece of technology, it is an actual specification, just a description of syntax and semantics of execution, nothing more. That said, at the moment it is already implemented for at least 15 programming languages, including Scala. So the Sangria is the Scala GraphQL implementation. It helps you build services and provide GraphQL API from your Scala applications. And in meantime, it is already used by a lot of companies. Some of them you might be familiar with, GraphQL, and in particular, Sangria. So today I would like to answer the question why, or at least try to give you an idea why those companies chose GraphQL, why they would like to use it, and what kind of benefit it might offer you in the contrast to, say, REST API. So I think it's always helpful to start looking at GraphQL when we look first at typical REST API interaction between client and server. So as the first thing, we have a client interaction that the client initiates an HTTP query to a server. So in this case, we have a simple HTTP request that asks for a product. REST API implemented in Scala or in some any other technology will go to a database, will look at this data up, and they will, then as the next step, it will give it back to a client. But as you can see here, what it gives back is some list of fields. It would be ID, name, description, and a bunch of other fields. In fact, most of the fields client probably will not be using. And this is where the first problem comes into play. It's called often referred to as overfetching. So overfetching is the problem where a client gets a lot of data, so server for some reason decided to give specific blob of JSON. For some reason, server said that this is a amount of data that client actually needs, even though there might be different clients, like iOS client, web application, Android client. And this becomes a problem, especially if you are working on mobile applications and provide a single API for different types of clients. Some people implement some API, provide things like whitelisting. Unfortunately, this is not standardized. Some API do it, and when they do, it is quite nice. But most API don't. Another problem that people often face is underfetching. So even though client got all of this data, this might not be enough for a client to operate. Like, for example, if client shows specific view of a product, client might need additional information to show, let's say, a category navigation or maybe related products. And in this case, some API, again, might provide some additional features. Like, for example, here, it allows expand to particular references and embed data of maybe related products inside of a JSON response. But some API do this kind of stuff. For example, API I work in, work with REST API, it has this feature, but most API don't. And even if API provides this, there's no standard how you can implement it in a way that is understood or agreed upon by many clients. Another important thing I think it's often overlooked is the evolution of API. So how to evolve API over time. And one of the important aspects of it is version. Like some people do versioning, but versioning has its own costs. It has a maintenance cost. So you need to make hard decisions about how many versions you would like to support, for how long, and it would be okay to break specific clients if you would like to drop support for older version. If you don't want to do versioning, you probably will end up doing something like deprecation, in particular deprecation of fields. But then it is not clear first how you communicate it to a client, and then how would you remove those deprecated fields? Like what would be the end goal? The best you can do in most cases is to define the time frame. Let's say 6 months, 2 years. After 2 years, you just hope for the best. You just hope that all clients don't use this field anymore because they read, for example, some markdown documentation somewhere. And this becomes a challenge. And unfortunately, there's no good answer, at least in my experience, in REST API or in general in web API. So, and those are challenges that Facebook also faced as they were working on their mobile application. What they came up with is actually quite similar, at least in terms of the basic interaction between client and server, it is quite similar. So, just like before, we have a client that makes an GraphQL request, so it is an HTTP request, although it's a little bit different. In this case, it asks for GraphQL endpoint, and it gives a query as a part of the payload. And the query is a GraphQL query. What it does here, it asks for a specific product with name and description. So it asks only for two fields out of product. And just like before, server actually goes to database and then gives a response to a client. In this case, though, a client gets only two fields, as we can see, the name and description of a product. Okay, so another, oh. No, I don't want to update it, so. It's quite, okay. I think we're back. Okay, so. I think another way to think about GraphQL query which is quite helpful, is to just imagine what would you like to get from the server. Like, for example, here, this is a type of product I would like, or type of JSON I would like to get from the server. After I imagined it, now I need to create a GraphQL query somehow. And the way I do it, I just drop all the values, because as a client, I know precisely which values I would like to get. But I don't have values. Values are stored on the server. So this is precisely what server can give me. And this is actually, in fact, a valid GraphQL query. You can actually execute it, and it will work just fine in terms of syntax. So again, this is you just drop values, and you describe only the keys that you would like to get in this kind of nested structure. OK, today I prepared, as I mentioned, a lot of demos. And I might go a little bit over time. I will try to do my best to do it in time, but we have about 10 different features that we will build on top of each other. The first one, it would be the basic example. I will show you how to build, how to define the schema, and how to execute query against it. As the next step, I will show you how you can expose this schema via API, via HTTP API, or via HTTP. Then we will learn about how you can put a database in SQL, in SQL database behind it. We will also learn how to paginate, filter, and sort the results, something that you normally do in REST API. We will also learn one important aspect about GraphQL in particular relationships between data, how you represent those relationships in the schema, and how you also optimize access to a database when relationships are involved. And the last part is, last but not the least, is actual security and also protection from abuse of API. As we'll learn, API, GraphQL API provides a little bit more flexibility than REST API, and this is why it needs a little bit more care when it comes to protection against intentional or unintentional abuse. Okay, with that said, I think it's a demo time, so let's hope for the best. Okay. So just let me know if you can hear me, if I got too far from the mic. Okay. So the first example, the most basic example, our goal here is to define the schema and to execute the schema against the query. The first thing, we need some data. So, and this data would be the book data. I guess it would be the most simple model I could imagine. So let's quickly look at the book itself. So the book is a simple case class. No surprises here. It's just ID, title, also ID and description. We also have a book repository here, but let's ignore it for the moment being it's a quite simple interface. We will use it later on to talk to a database. But for now, let's focus on the book case class. I defined a list, a simple list of books, and as a next step, one important aspect of GraphQL is that we need to define the schema. And the schema is, you can think of it as a meta information about your data. In this case, I defined an object type for a book, it's called a book, and it is implemented in terms of a book case class that I just showed you. Let's call this type a GraphQL type. So we define a GraphQL type with description of meta information, and it might and you can define fields just like you do in Scala for a case class. The same is valid for GraphQL types. Here, fields have three main components: name, obviously, and the GraphQL type, and the last part is resolve function. So the resolve function is important because it defines a connection between your business logic, a business logic of your application, and the GraphQL metadata, the GraphQL schema. It tells how ID on a book type, on a book GraphQL type relates to your model. In this case, it's the case class book. Because at the moment I'm working with a book case class, the implementation is quite simple. I can access a book via this value argument, so it's given me as an argument, and I can extract an ID from it. And the same true for title and author ID. So in this scenario, the actual implementation of this connection between my internal model and GraphQL object is very simple. The next step is a little bit special. Because if you think about the query, at some point you need to start. You need to start query with some field. Like in my previous example, it was a product. So I need to start it with the product, and then I can ask for fields from this product. In our case, we would like to start the query with the books, which means I need to define this entry point somewhere. And this entry point would be the query type. In this case, so query type has this special meaning that it is an entry point in my query. This is where you can start. Those fields are available as root fields when you start to write the GraphQL query. And just like before, we define a field books, but because we don't really have anything to define it in terms of, it is an entry point. We don't have anything just yet. My implementation of resolve function is very simple. Like I just return this list of books that I defined before, right here. Okay, Now that we define the schema, and here when I parameterize the schema, I give it this entry point, the query type. Now we are actually done. So this is our GraphQL API, although we not expose it in any way yet, but we can execute it. So for example, here I define the query. This is, by the way, a macro. It will validate the syntax, so you will get a compilation error if you get syntax wrong. In this case, we ask for a book, title, and author ID. So we are using those fields that we defined before, but we are picking only specific fields that we would like to get in the result. And as a last step, we actually can execute a query against the schema. As a result, we get a JSON. In this case, I'm using Circe library, so I get just a simple JSON blob as a result. Of course, wrap in the future. So let's look how it executes. And as you probably imagine, there's no surprises here. Because when you know the query, you already know what kind of shape of result you will get. So here, as a result, I get a JSON blob, which contains books. And inside of a book, I have a title and an author ID. So this is the most basic way how you can execute the query. Although it is basic, it is also by itself quite useful, in particular for tests. So this demo project contains a lot of, or at least some tests, and they actually use this approach. It is quite simple to execute just on JVM in a test, in a SCAR test. Okay, and what I don't like here, though, is the problem that let's look at a book once again. So it is a simple case class. I already have defined those fields like ID and title. They already have types, those are Scala types, but nonetheless, I define this important piece of information about my model. And what I don't like here is I need to repeat myself. I need to replicate those definitions in a little bit different style. And this is what we can avoid. So it would be our second example. By the way, in this green color here, I will highlight new things that I added so that you can focus on those, because everything else we already looked at, those examples built on top of each other. So you can only see a difference what has changed in comparison to the previous example. So in this case, only one single line has changed. We, instead of defining this book explicitly, manually, we actually can derive its structure with this macro. And we will come back to this macro a little bit later because it provides a lot of flexibility, so you can customize nearly any aspect of the actual case class derivation. But to show you an example, let's quickly run it. So everything else stays the same. We just using macro to derive the structure of the case class. And as you can see, the output is exactly the same. So in terms of the structure and execution semantics, it's exact equivalent of what we had before. Okay, so I think now that we are familiar with how we define the schema and how we can execute it, I think it's time to expose it via HTTP API. So let's close this one. Okay, so now the first part stays unchanged. So we have the same schema, but the second part is a little bit different. In this case, I would like to expose GraphQL schema via HTTP API. So I'm using here Akka HTTP. In order to do so, first I need the system and Akka materializer. And as a next step, I need to define a set of routes to my GraphQL endpoint. I put them in a separate function just because there's nothing special about those routes. Those are simple endpoints, just like you would define in a normal REST API. In this case, I'm defining an endpoint that is called GraphQL. It supports GET and POST. And when it is requested by a client, this function would be called. And those three pieces of information come actually from the request. The query is one of the most important, it is mandatory element. We already looked at it. So this is a GraphQL query. An operation name and variables, those are optional. You might use them. Operation name is useful when you have multiple queries inside of a single document, so you can pick and choose which one you would like to execute. And variables allow you to parameterize a GraphQL query. We will not look at those in detail because they are optional and they don't really that important. What is the most important is the actual schema that we defined before and the query which we would like to execute against the schema. So the execution itself is stays the same. So it is exactly the same what we did just in our simple Scala application. As a last step, we need to start the HTTP server, and we give an HTTP server our route definition. So let's start it. So I think the server is started. So let's go to port 8080. I think it has something to do with the full screen mode. Yep. Okay, so now what you see in here is called GraphQL Playground. It is actually, in fact, a simple HTML page that I copy-pasted in my project. It doesn't know anything about my specific schema about my project. It's like I mentioned, it's just a static HTML page which is just copy-pasted. Yet it allows me to do a lot of interesting things. For example, let's execute this query that we tried before. So here we have books, and from books we would like to get, let's see, okay, title, and as before, let's ask for an author ID. Okay, now I execute and I get exactly the same results. Big enough. Exactly the same results as we saw earlier in Scala, but there's, you probably notice there's a small difference here. A nice feature that this tool provides to me is an auto completion. So for example, here I can ask, actually it knows precisely which fields are available on a book. When I hover over this element, it will show me that okay, this is a book type. It can even give me the structure information about the structure and field available fields and even documentation here. So how does this work? Like, how does this tool knows like what my schema is all about? Because the only thing I did, I only exposed this simple HTML HTTP endpoint with that allows me to execute my GraphQL queries. And the answer to this question is the fact that GraphQL has a powerful introspection API. So when we define this meta information about the schema, those GraphQL types, we actually define the metadata, which is also part of the API. And this is a very important aspect of GraphQL. So for example, here I can ask not only about a book, the book data itself, but I can also ask about the type information about the book, book type. So here let's ask for its name, and let's ask for a list of fields. Let's just show the name of the fields. So as you can see in the results, we get the actual data and the description of the type, which means that suddenly our type system that we allow in Scala is transitions the boundary of our process. It is part of the API, and it is exposed. Although it is a type system, it is not the Scala type system. It is simpler, but it still provides a lot of power. For example, it has interfaces, it has union types, and scalar types, and many other features. So it is quite close to Scala, and which also means that our API is a type safe, and this information is available for those tools like GraphQL Playground that I'm using here, but also you can use this information to generate documentation as a part of your CI pipeline. Or you build powerful tools that generate code for iOS and Android. In fact, those tools already exist. So as soon as you have a GraphQL endpoint, you can take advantage of the huge community effort that is going on right now. There's a lot of projects, very good and mature projects are available to take advantage of this type information that you're exposing. Okay, so now that we have HTTP API, the next step we can take is to actually connect it to a database. So this would be our next topic, and this is where our book repository comes into play. Here I also added additional type definition. It's for an author, so because it becomes more interesting if you have two types, book and the author of the book. Okay, so now the only change here is this first type parameter. So this first type, we already looked at the second type parameter. It defines the type, the scalar type, in terms of which you define the GraphQL type. But the first one is a little bit different. Its purpose is to provide a way to resolve function to access a database, or to get some contextual information about the execution, like, for example, an authenticated user. And we will see it in later examples, how you can use this context object to propagate authentication token that comes from our authorization or authentication. But for now, it's quite simple. So I just have those two repositories to load books and load authors from SQL database. And this is what I give it as a first type argument. And I can access it via this CTX property. So I can say CTX, and then I can actually access those methods, like all books. Let's look at it again. So this is this function. Just ignore those arguments for the moment being. We don't need them. They all have default values, so it's it should work just fine. Important point here is the result, and as you can see, it's just a simple future of a list of books, or just a future of a book, which means you can put anything behind it. It might be, in our example, it would be a SQL database, but it also might be a microservice inside of your infrastructure, and you can talk to this microservice via gRPC or Swift. So in terms of, as far as this interface is concerned, it doesn't matter where the data actually comes from. Okay, so now in our resolve functions, we actually using context objects, so we don't have this static list, some global list of books anymore. We can express the resolve function in terms of its argument and access context. So now the question comes, how can I provide this context? And this would be our next step here. We create the database, we connect to the database, and we instantiate this repository, so it is an SQL implementation of this interface. And as a next step, we give this repository to an execution. So when we execute, we need to provide those three important components: the schema, the query, and the actual data storage, or some contextual objects that allows resolve functions to load the data. Okay, so let's start this example. So let's quickly refresh this one. We don't need the introspection results anymore. Okay, so as you can see here, we now have much bigger list. Like it's a list of books of different political philosophers, if it's yours. Okay, now the thing I don't like is that now I get the data from a database, but I get all the data. Unfortunately, or at least there was a limit 100, but still, it is a huge amount of data. What I would like to do is to actually provide a pagination over this data. And this would be our next example. So how would you do this in GraphQL? How do you allow pagination, sorting, and filtering? And to do this, just before we do it, let's quickly look at our repository once again. So here's our book repo. And here we have limit and offset, so those allow to paginate over the data. The next one is sorting, so it just allows you to sort by ID. As you can see at the bottom, we have a simple enum with ID and title. And the last one is title, which is a filter, so I can filter by title. One important thing I would like to point out here is that in my Scala repository, I explicitly allow to filter and sort by title and ID, simply because I know that those are efficient and performant. Because I know I have an index in my database on those fields. This means that I will never expose here, I will not allow to filter by some arbitrary field. I only expose those fields that I know would be efficient when I actually query them, or filter by them, or do the sorting. And in fact, in GraphQL, the concept is exactly the same. So fields that we defined before, they actually can have arguments. This would be our next example. So here, first I start my query type with actual definitions of arguments. And I have exactly the same arguments as we saw before, like limit and offset for pagination, sorting, and filtering. So in GraphQL, I need to define them, I need to declare them explicitly. And it is important because, remember, we are exposing meta information about API, which means this all of this data is actually available as a part of our API. And you can document it. So it is. It provides documentation, but also it provides a lot of. It is used to do a lot of validation when a query comes in, and we need to ensure that this query actually conforms to the schema. It is a valid query. We should also include things like default value. So default value here is not only the runtime value that would be actually used as a default for a limit, but it is also a part of the documentation. So there's no longer this problem where you have documented one default in let's say a Markdown documentation, and then you have at runtime a very different behavior because you forgot to update the defaults or forgot to update the documentation. This is a single source of truth. Okay, now that we did it, in our resolve functions, we actually can just ask for those values of those arguments, and execute and run give them directly to all books function just like before. So let's try to and see how it goes. So, well, server is starting. So now, actually, as you can see, it already knows like what is available. I can ask for, let's say, first three elements, and then I can sort by, I don't know, let's sort by title. And as you can see in the results, we actually get sorted results, and we only have three of the elements, three books. I can also filter, for example, here I can say title. So this is in general how you do those things in GraphQL. So you just define arguments to implement things like pagination, sorting, and filtering. By the way, here in documentation you will also see, and you can see the limit is actually has default, so it is part of the documentation, and it is also used for auto completion by this tool. But it is not only limited to pagination, as you see, those arguments are quite generic, so you can use it for things like maybe special business logic. For example, you can provide a locale or just imagination is your limit, like what things you would like to parameterize for specific values of fields. Okay, so this is this example is a next step. What I don't like here is that I have an author ID. What I actually would like to show my application is data about this person. I would like to show the name and maybe biography together with the book title. In order to do so, we need to introduce a relationship at this place. And this would be our next example. So the only place that is changed here is the actual book definition. And the book definition now, we can still use macro, but the difference here is that macro can take parameters, and you can customize nearly any aspect of the derived type class, case class, or the derived GraphQL type, which is based on the case class. In this case, though, I don't want to delete the author ID. I actually still want to keep it because if my client, let's say my iOS application, relies on this ID, it is not that easy to just get rid of this field. I need to go, for example, through this App Store process where I need to submit my change and it needs to be approved. So I can't just delete this field. If I do so, it probably will break my applications on the actual mobile devices of customers. So in this case, I can actually duplicate this field. So, and this is a feature of GraphQL. It supports duplication, and this duplication is also part of the documentation. It is part of the schema. And in this case, I also provide a hint what users need to use instead. And now, as a second step, I also define an author field. And this field also has this resolve function. where we just load and also by ID. And this is pretty much it. So this is the only change here on a book type. We added one field and we duplicated existing field. And at the bottom, you will see this middleware. So the middleware allows you to inject particular instrumentation during the execution. We will see a better example of it later. But for now, I just would like to include this small tracing middleware to show you how you can analyze performance issues. Okay, so now let's start. Oh. Yeah, it's the right one. Okay, let's restart our example. I think I removed those limits just to simplify it a bit. Okay, now you can see it's already yellow. Like it shows me you're not supposed to be using this field. It actually helps me to migrate my API because it knows this information. This information is a part of API and public documentation about API. What is also important is that when client sends a query, it always needs to specify all the fields. Which means that on the server side, it is very beneficial because we always know which fields are still in use by clients. Which means that when we duplicate field and when we later on decide to delete this field, we can base our decision based on purely on heuristics. For example, we can measure for 2 months if nobody asks for this field. Probably nobody uses it anymore, and people already migrated their applications. If people still using it, you will see it, and then you can make an informed decision about deletion of the duplication fields. But we don't need it anymore right now, so we can say, let's ask for an author. And now, as you can see, we get all those derived fields from an author. I haven't showed you the case class, but I will show you it in a second. It's just a simple case class, just like a book. And now we actually get information about relationships. What is important to notice here is that you probably noticed by this point that GraphQL result is just a simple JSON. And JSON is a tree, so it is not a graph. So the question is, people often ask, why is it called GraphQL, even though I get a simple JSON tree as a result? And the answer is not the output, but the conceptual model. GraphQL tries to represent API as a set of related entities, types, and relations between types. And this is precisely what we are seeing here. We see in the book type, and we can see it even more clear in the documentation. So we see a book, and it has a field which is called author, and author is yet another type. And I can dig those relationships and understand model without relying on IDs, which actually my foreign and primary keys in my database. But I don't want to expose the database. I would like to expose a natural model of the API, which doesn't necessarily rely on IDs, but it relies on types and relationships between types. Okay, when I just introduced this relationship, I introduced a serious problem. And to demonstrate this problem, I would like to make a simple experiment. And this experiment is actually quite... let's make quickly open my in-memory database. And there's a place here, in particular here, I actually load, this one does an SQL query. It is implemented with Slick and H2 SQL database. So it is in memory, but still nonetheless, it is an SQL query. And here I would like to do something quite simple. So I say, okay, we have an SQL statement here going on, and I just would like to put like which author IDs we are loading, which how many SQL statements do we have. And now when we start this this example once again, we can execute this query just once. I will click on the once. And as you can see here, we have a lot of queries here. And those are often duplicated. Like we have duplicated IDs and we have a bunch of queries, SQL queries, which are independent from each other. And this is not a nice place to be in. One of the ways how you can solve this problem is that you can actually implement an analyzer of a GraphQL query. Because you know those fields in advance, you can generate an a big SQL query out of it with joins, maybe complex joins, which might be efficient on the database side. And in fact, there are products that, or products and libraries that actually do, doing precisely this. So they're taking GraphQL query and they compile it to an SQL query, which you can execute all at once, and you get precisely the data you need for your GraphQL response. This approach has downsides, though. It relies heavily on SQL. And for example, if in this case I have my book and my author coming from different places, let's say a book comes from a microservice via gRPC, and author data comes from Elasticsearch, I cannot rely on SQL anymore. I can't make joins between those types. So what I would like to show you is an alternative example that shows how you can solve and optimize this type of access, data access, without relying on SQL or any specific database technology or client technology for that matter. So let's quickly start it. And let's go to our next example. And the example is called Fetchers. So in this case, I define an author fetcher. The idea of fetcher is that it is you can think of it as a function. Given an author repository and a list of IDs of an author, I can load those IDs in batch. So just load them all at once in SQL. And this is a quite simple SQL statement, something like ID in, and then you give a list of IDs. So now that I have this function, I have this fetcher, I can actually use it in my resolve function. In my resolve function, I can say, okay, author fetcher dot defer, and then give it an author ID. And what it does, instead of immediately going to a database and loading this data on the spot, it actually says, okay, I don't care when you load it, just load it eventually at some point. Here's an ID for you. You have the fetcher, so you know how to load the data from a database. Just do it at some point. And in fact, execution engine actually knows precisely when is the best time to go to the database and load this data at once in one single batch. So this is pretty much it. So we defined information how to load data in batches from a database. We actually used it to defer loading from our resolve function. And as a last thing, we need to give this information about the fetcher to actual execution engine, so it knows about this function that can execute it. Okay, so let's start it. And see how it performs. So from this perspective, it should be the same. And as you can see here, we only see one single SQL statement now. And it loads all those IDs, all those author IDs at once without any duplicates. And it is very powerful technology. Quite powerful approach. You can get very far with it. As we'll see later, you can not only use it just by getting data by ID, but you can also use foreign key relationships, like with the connection between book and an author. And by the way, this tracing middleware that I showed you before, this is actually here. So this is how you can analyze the performance of every single field. Like for example, here I can execute requests with the tracing information. This is precisely why I included this middleware before to see this information. And it is very helpful because in most cases the actual performance problems come not from the actual GraphQL execution, but some field made very expensive GraphQL query, SQL query, for example. I just need to figure out which field this is, and this is very helpful to have this type of information about execution of actual requests, how long every individual field took to execute. You can also push this stuff to things like InfluxDB or Datadog or whatever metric system you are using in your project. Okay, now that we have this example, I think that we can very quickly look. I think we are closing, it is very close to an end. So I would like to quickly look at different, or the relation in a different direction from an author to a list of books. And this is what we have in here. So I have an author type, and this is now adding a new field, which is list of books. I don't need to duplicate anything because there was no ID on an author. So in this case, I'm actually adding in GraphQL something that was not doesn't exist on my case class at all. Like this relationship is more bound to a book, but in this case, I would like to provide this nice piece of functionality on my GraphQL API. This nice relationship in both directions. And I'm using fetcher here as well. So I define a fetcher for a book, although it is a little bit bigger, because we also need to define not only loading data by ID, but like I mentioned before, I can also define this type of special relationship where I have one to many connection between two different types. And this is precisely why this second function exists. But other than this, this is the same approach. So I'm still using this fetch framework to load the data. So let's quickly look at it. Okay, the server is started. Okay, so now we can ask. Now it knows that there's a books field, and I can ask for a title. So let's move trace information. Let's run it again. Wonderful. So now we actually have the connection in both directions, from book to an author, and from author to a list of books that belong to this author. But maybe you notice here, we introduce a serious problem. In fact, this problem was here all along. Let's continue. Well, there's nothing that stops me from doing this. I mean, we optimize access to our database, so it is actually very fast. Well, it would be fast when I execute it. So now, well, it was instantaneous. Like I get, but I get humongous amount of response. Like this resulting blob of JSON is humongous. In fact, this is very dangerous to expose those mutually recursive types, because you can misuse it like this. But in fact, this is not a problem with recursive types. For example, I can ask, I have a limit here for on a book. And on a book, I can ask for a million of books with one only single title, with a single field, a title of a book. So well, how can you possibly solve this type of problem on API level? Like, well, one of the things you can do is to define the timeout. You probably will have it in your API as well, regardless of whether it's GraphQL or REST API. You can also limit the query by depth. So you can say, if you have 5 levels of depth in your query, just don't execute it. But those two approaches are not optimal. They have some, they're not very flexible, because they don't really reflect the nature of the data. They only reflect particular structural element or timing of the execution of request. What I would like to show you is an alternative approach that you can use. And in this case, so let's quickly stop it. And it would be our next example. So in this approach, what I would like to do is, I would like to make a static analysis of a query. So let's say for every single field in a query, I give it a price of 1. But some fields are more expensive than others. For example, this when I load an author information, I know, okay, it uses this fetch framework, so, but it still goes to a database, so it is optimal, so I optimized it, but it still needs to access to a database. This means that I gave it a higher price. In this case, my price is 10. And the same I did on an author, when I asked for a list of books, it just also uses fetches, and it still goes to database. So it is more expensive than other fields. This last field, the list of books on a query type, which has a limit, it is very dangerous, because it directly goes to a database. So my formula for this one is a little bit more involving. First, I need to consider that I need to go to a database immediately. I give it 100, okay, it's super expensive, just to make a round trip to a database. But then I also need to consider, if my limit is 100, in the worst case scenario, I get 100 elements from a database. And in order to incorporate it in this formula, I actually multiply a limit by the price of the children, the sub-selections of a book. So this is my formula for complexity of a book, of this book's field. And as a last step, I need to define the query reducers. So query reducer is very similar to similar to middleware, but it runs before the query execution. It can analyze a query, it can reduce a query to a specific value, and it can make some interesting decisions based on this value. Like for example, the reject complex queries reducer, what it will do, it will try to find this number, the price of the whole query, and then it will just simply reject queries that exceed particular threshold, 200 in this case. So let's start quickly this example, and let's see how my server will react when I try to execute the same query once again. So if I will run it again, it will say, okay, I don't even try, I don't want to execute your query, it's too expensive. If I will simplify it, it will be much more happy about it. So now it actually executes. But then again, if I will, let's quickly refresh because the introspection has changed. Okay, now if I ask it for a limit, a ridiculous limit, well, it says, no, I don't want to do it. Like, it doesn't make any sense. In fact, this is kind of intentional. It might be intentional and unintentional abuse. In my experience, actually, unintentional abuse is quite, happens often. For example, in some cases, our front-end developers came to me and they asked, okay, why do we get this error? And we look in the query, and it turns out that they asked for humongous amount of elements, the limit was huge, and they asked for a huge amount of fields that were actually, some of them were quite expensive. And my answer was, okay, you have a choice. Either you ask for some cheap and smaller subset of fields with a bigger limit, or you have a smaller limit, but you ask for more interesting fields, more expensive fields for every single element. And this is very valuable tool also as a communication. And spreading this information, understanding about execution characteristics of your API, like how the complexity analysis incorporates the limits and the semantic elements of your API. Okay, now we are going a little bit over time. I'm very sorry about it. I would like to quickly show you one last example, which is authorization and authentication, because this is normally what you have in a real API. So I really would like to show you that you can actually do it with GraphQL as well. It would be very fast, I promise you. Okay, so in this example, my book and author, those two types are public information, nothing special about them. But what I also would like to introduce is a type called me. This is information about me as an API user. I might have my own API token, authentication token, and I have my type so I can access my name and list of my favorite books. We defined the type before. So here we define the type for me to access my fields. We on the query type we also introduce a new field called me as well. It is of me type. And the only thing I need to add here is I need to give it a list of tags. And these tags are just a piece of static meta information about this field. This tag says that, okay, this field requires authorization. This field requires authentication token from HTTP request. What it doesn't do, it doesn't influence execution in any specific way. It's just a piece of meta information. And in order to implement the behavior that we would like to do to have in our API, to protect API with authentication token, is actually would be a middleware. So here I created a simple authentication middleware that will, let's look at it. So before the field is executed, the GraphQL field is executed, this function is called. And in this function, I can actually ask interesting questions, like, for example, does this field has an authorized tag on it? If it has this authorized tag, this means that this field requires authentication. And in my context, object, I actually put an OAuth token in the context itself. So I can actually access it and I can check whether this token is defined or not. And if token is not defined, but the field requires authentication, I just throw an exception and I say, okay, no, you are not allowed to execute this field. And let's quickly see how it goes. In order to show it to you, I also need to copy paste my special token. So as you can see, this token is a standard OAuth bearer token. In a, if you look at demo later, you can find the full example and you will see how it feels exactly. So let's refresh. Sorry, when I'm in hurry, I'm making mistakes. Okay, now let's quickly refresh it again. So, okay, and now quickly execute the query. I have me, and I can ask for my name and list of books with titles. Okay, now it says unauthorized because, well, I just tried to execute a query and I can't get access to this field. In order to do so, I actually need to provide a header, and it would be my special authentication token, so it's a bearer header, so it's OAuth. And now I actually get this field. So the actual authorization and authentication is very fine granular. So you can make it very fine granular on the level of individual fields. And this is very powerful concept. Also, what is powerful is that GraphQL itself doesn't know anything about authentication or authorization. It only knows, though SunGrail provides, for example, this middleware where you can actually integrate your existing authentication services with GraphQL. And with this, our demo is finished. So we learned how to, from the most basic examples, how to define the schema and how to execute it just in simple Scala code. Then we learned how to expose it via HTTP and put a database behind it. We also learned how to paginate, filter, sort the results of those lists that we expose via GraphQL API. Then we learned about relationships and how GraphQL allows you to model your API in terms of relationships and how you can make this those relationships efficient when they are loaded from a database. And as a last step, we looked how we can secure API and protect our API from intentional and unintentional abuse. And on this note, I would like to thank you for your patience and thank you for staying patiently, even though we went a little bit over time. So those links, the first link is those presentation slides. The second link is the actual demo project. I would highly recommend you to check it out if this is something that is interesting to you. The last thing is my Twitter. I don't think that we have time for questions right now. But I would stay outside of this room, and I would be happy to have a conversation with you. But if you will not get an opportunity to meet here, you can always ping me on Twitter. I would be happy to have a conversation and to answer all of your questions. So thank you very much.